Hey guys, today we're going to talk about passive safety. Lately, you guys have seen us work on other cars, and we always talk about performance, 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 and we don't really talk about normal cars. Well, today we're going to talk about our regular 2005 Honda Civic, and we're going to talk about how we can make this vehicle perform better and also be more safe. So we talk about performance a lot, but we can make a normal car like this perform really well too. So here we have Akebono disc brakes, and we have Akebono pads on our vehicle, so we have ceramic pads. And I am a big fan of this brand because they work really well, they can take a beating, and they don't cost a lot either. Like, these are just their regular basic replacements. And you can see that they're zinc coated. They have a bit of a coating here, so we just, you know, take some brake cleaner and then we go ahead and brake them in. Now, we decided to go with blanks. It's not a very big rotor, and we wanted to maximize contact patch on initial bite because we're not really taking this car on the track. We're not taking this thing really through mountain roads aggressively. Like, yeah, we can go snowboarding with the car, but we're not going to be aggressive with it. So I believe a rotor like this that's blank, that's vented, is going to have a much better initial bite technically than a cross-drilled or slotted, or cross-drilled and slotted, which I'm not a fan of. I prefer only cross-drilled or only slotted, and the reason for that is you want to maximize friction area. So the blank rotor on initial bite will grab better because you have all of this metal to grab onto. Now, over time, with lots of brake applications, gas builds up with the pad, it has a hard time grabbing onto that rotor. We lose friction. So that's where slotted or cross-drilled comes in. Now, the problem with cross-drilled and slotted, not only do you guys lose a lot of surface area, you also weaken the rotor as well. Now, I know a lot of people use them, but if you look at like really high-end brakes, usually most cars, like even race cars, will either use something like this or slotted. A lot of the newer Mercedes, the AMGs, will just only use cross-drilled. And I know some manufacturers are trying to introduce both because the idea makes sense, but I like to pick one or the other. Also, on a blank rotor, these are a lot easier to resurface. Not a lot of people resurface rotors, but if you get a good quality one, you can, and you can get more bang for your buck. I did have my power stops. They're power slots before. Now they're power stop, I believe, that brand changed. Those ones are high quality slotted rotor, and they're thicker. I was able to have them machined, but a lot of people don't have the tooling to do it, so you might want to consider that as well when you're picking your discs. And for what it's worth, went down to Lorico, my local auto parts store, and I grabbed new guide pins as well. They're cheap. And when you have one guide pin, the other ones looked okay, but when you have a guide pin that's this corroded, you see that the bushing here, it's just completely toast, you might as well change it out, because I was having such a hard time taking this out, and I'm pretty sure that's why the left side pretty much prematurely wore out the down to the squealer. And you could just tell because the caliper, it's a floating caliper, it couldn't move anymore. So instead of trying to salvage this for how cheap it is, just get new ones. Now that you have the rotor and pad that you've chosen, we now have to apply pressure, or we have to get those parts to work. So you always want to make sure that your brake lines, your flex lines mainly, are in good condition. Also, your hard lines, you want to make sure that they're not rusting or corroding. They will have to be replaced. Now, we have elected to go with stainless steel braided lines. These are from Russell Performance. My car has Stop Tech. There are lots of other brands out there, but this one is Russell Performance for this particular vehicle. Now, if you have good conditioned rubber lines, they are going to work just fine. Now, what the difference is, this car on a hot summer day is less likely to get a mushy feel because the stainless steel braided line helps the hose maintain its original diameter, giving you proper brake feel. So these are more durable over time. I've used these for about 10 years on my other vehicles, and we've just acquired this car, and we've decided to go with these again, and the brake feel does feel pretty good, especially on those hot summer days. Avoiding a mushy brake pedal feel means you are applying the effort you're putting in the pedal to the caliper, which then squeezes on the pads onto the disc, creating friction. If it's feeling mushy, it's not grabbing on that hard, so you're losing braking power. Now, let's say that you're coming to an obstacle and you cannot brake in time and you need to swerve around it. Well, that's where your sway bar is going to come in, and also your shocks and springs. So here we have switched over to Moog sway bar and links. Now, the reason why we switched to Moog, they're cost effective and they are much larger than stock, and you see here that they have grease fittings, so you can get much more life out of them by greasing them every oil change. So I like these just because of how much better the car handles. Even with sticking with the stock sway bar, we have less play and less deflection on a big piece like this. our car is older, so we swapped out the old rubber bushings for the sway bar. Rubber inherently is just gonna be more comfortable and is soft, but also degrades over time. So we switch over to Moog again. There's energy suspension Moogs, typically what I pick, and these are polyurethane. So the Moog pieces are pretty cheap and they're significantly more stiff. So when we make evasive maneuvers, the car is gonna stay more level. Shocks and springs or struts and springs are the next thing. You see here that these are original. We have not changed them out, but we should talk about them anyways. Our struts or shocks are what controls the vehicle. So when you go over bumps and everything, that's what helps soften up the ride. Also, when you brake hard, having a good shock will help stop nosedive, or if you're accelerating, stopping squat or minimizing how much squat the car has. Spring rate also has a lot to do with this. This is a linear spring. You also have progressive springs. If you were to do a lowering spring, there are advantages to doing that. You will have a lower center of gravity. On a stock style car like this, I don't mind lowering it 1 inch. You're still pretty practical. On my 350, I didn't lower it because it's already pretty low as it sits already. So you can lower the center of gravity by changing out to aftermarket springs. And you can also change the spring rate. Keep in mind, if you go too low, you might have clearance issues over time. So you have to think about how you're using the vehicle. For most of you on a daily driver like this, keep the stock springs, but put in a performance shock dampener. Whenever you're servicing anything, especially when it comes to brakes and chassis, make sure you're using a torque wrench and you're torquing everything down to manufacturer specifications. Now, it's a really good idea, whether you do your brakes yourself or if you have a shop take off that wheel, re-torque them yourself. When you get back home from a shop, let's say, if they service something for wheel shop, whatever, loosen off the lug nuts, put them back on, use your torque wrench. Make sure your torque wrench is recalibrated. The reason why I'm saying that is a lot of shops will use torque sticks, and torque sticks work when they're fresh, but they have a lifespan. And you don't know if their torque sticks still work. So they're like, oh yeah, it's torqued down to manufacturer specs. If this has uneven pressure on it or too much, you can warp your rotors prematurely, and then you're back in the shop again. So just peace of mind, make sure that these, especially with all these aluminum parts being used on these newer vehicles, make sure that is torqued, aluminum wheels, I should say, make sure it's torqued down correctly. And let's not forget the most important safety feature in your vehicles, guys, it's your tires. It is the only thing that touches the road. So for us, we run two sets to optimize our traction because we have quite a bit of range of conditions where we live. So we have winters that go roughly between 0 degrees Celsius down to, on average, maybe 15 degrees Celsius. Not that cold where we live. And then our summers range anywhere between 20 degrees Celsius up to 35 on a really hot day. So we, now that we understand what our temperature conditions are and our driving conditions are, we can then buy the appropriate tires. We can just buy regular all seasons for most of the time when it's just dry or raining out. We do have to pick some, these tires came with the car. I'm going to try to find a tire that's really well suited towards the wet because it does rain quite a bit where we live. And I am going to get studded winter tires. The reason why I'm going to get studded winter tires is because, one, it's legal here. Two, the problem with our area is it will, at night, it'll go down to zero, minus two, minus five, which is enough to make water freeze. But then during the day, it'll go up to, even up to 10 degrees Celsius. So all that, if we ever do get snow, it just melts and then it'll flash freeze overnight and then you'll get patches of black ice. Now, studded snow tires are not going to make you invincible. It'll just give you a very marginal chance when you hit black ice. We need every chance we can get to have traction because I'd rather have something than not have it at all. Well, we just took the car for a drive and it drives pretty good as far as like a regular economy car goes. So as you guys can see, you don't have to spend a ton of money to get better than average performance from your daily driver. So you can see we went with a good quality rotor, we chose ceramic pads, and we like to use polyurethane bushings and stainless steel braided lines. Those items are pretty cheap, and when cars get older, you have to change them anyways. So you don't have to buy the most expensive thing. You don't have to like, oh, how am I going to get RSX brakes on this thing? Or how am I going to, you know, get a big brake kit? You don't have to worry about stuff like that. You can get pretty good performance just by using premium parts. If you like today's content, make sure to check out my channel and hit the subscribe button and make sure to hit that bell notification. What that does is it makes sure that you're always kept up to date with all the content that we're providing with you guys on YouTube. So the way that we have the channel set up is I have the uploads up top. That way at all times, you can always see, if you just hop by the channel, what our latest upload is. Plus with the bell notification, you're going to get some sort of
message from YouTube itself. We also have popular uploads, car videos, how-to videos, demonstration and informational videos, and a lot of cool other specific car videos like our builds playlist. I really like the builds playlist because it takes all the theories from our how-to section and it keeps applying it to different vehicles.